so you know I'm LaDonna. We're very excited to share with you today as we talk about building resiliency with families. I work as a TA specialist in the western part of the state. And Jennifer, would you just mind introducing yourself just a little bit as our special guest today?
Certainly. My name is Jennifer Washburn, and I am the executive director and owner of iKids. We've been open for over 20 years now, and so I am going to be giving the meat and potatoes and the specifics about how we work to use the protective factors. You'll learn about those very soon, but how we use and embed the protective factors in everything we do when it comes to working with our families.
So when we talk about building resilience, that's a very important piece. And a lot of us have been struggling being resilient people ourselves. I know that I have personally struggled with being resilient, and I don't have a space full of kiddos. So the first thing we need you all to do, and this is about your credit into ECE TRIS, so there's going to also be opportunities for participation, but we need to monitor attendance. So using the chat feature, I'm just going to want you to take a few minutes to enter your name as it is entered in ECE TRIS and enter the name of your center. So you can just do that. We'll do that on one big line. So if you've got ahead of the game, like some of you are, and you've already typed your name, I need you to type your name, and behind your name, type the name of your center. And remember, this is as it appears in ECE TRIS. So we'll give you a few moments to do that.
Carol Thomas, if you wouldn't mind going back and adding in the center or the agency that you're with, that would be great. Add it with your name, Melody Joseph, if you would add your name and your center on the same line. So don't hit return yet. Put them together for us.
Carol might be retired.
Even that too. And I'll put, I'm jealous.
So it's going to be really important. We want to make sure that you receive credit. So please type that in there. If you are struggling with entering something in the chat box and you were not able to enter your name and your center on the same line, can you just stay on briefly? Just make sure you write yourself a little note. I need to stay on to make sure I get credit. And Jennifer's going to move on and we're going to go to the next slide. But please
hit chat. We also want to let you know that while you're using that chat, we do have someone, Miss Julie's going to be monitoring. So make sure that you check that out. If you have questions as we go along, if you have comments, it is great participation to put some thumbs up every now and then so that LaDonna and I know you're still there and you haven't just put your cute little face up in the holder and you ran away. We understand that can happen, but also we want to remind you to please stay present because there will be opportunities along the way where we're going to give you some prompts. We're going to ask you to put some things in the chat because we want to know you're here for the next hour and a half.
Okay, so these are our objectives today. We're going to talk about research-informed protective factors to build resilient families. We're going to talk about new ideas. We're going to learn how to take those protective factors and use strategies within your childcare centers to help build strong families. And then we're going to talk about something really, really intentional, planning for intentionality, talking about intentional ways to use the protective factors with families. Okay, so Jennifer mentioned protective factors. I mentioned protective factors. These are research-informed factors that make all families strong. The first one is parent resilience. The next one, social connections, knowledge of parenting and child development, concrete support in times of need, social-emotional competence, and nurturing and attachment. Those are kind of our guides as we go through this. And you'll see that Jennifer has little stars on there that she'll be sharing in ways that she does that within her own center. So we're going to look at each one of these protective factors and how we can implement parent engagement strategies and ways to build these protective factors in our families.
So before we go further, if you would just take a half a second, look at these protective factors, and we want to do a little bit of an assessment of our own. If you have heard of the protective factors, put a yes in the chat box so that we know who has heard of the protective factors. If you have not heard of the protective factors, please put a no. We're not trying to call you out. We just want to assess going from the beginning who's already got some background information on this. Take a sec and stick some info in the chat. Sometimes it's easier just to put a yes or a no. I could have you get really fancy and put a thumbs up or a thumbs down, but that might break the internet. So we'll just go, this is a no. And again, if you've not, that's actually exciting. If you have, that's exciting too. Hopefully before the end of today, you're going to find some new ways to be able to make the protective factors as common as writing your name or filling out paperwork if you're in a center.
Okay, so I'm gonna start off by talking about parent resilience. We're not going to practice raising our hands in the chat box or using the feature, but I have had many days when I did not feel like a very resilient person, especially over the past year, right? Things kept coming at you as childcare centers, and you would get over one hump and then you would face another, and then you might also have struggles at home. So just a brief definition, and I'm going to share a little bit more about what parent resilience is: managing stress and functioning well when faced with challenges, adversity, and trauma. And we all know going in as childcare directors or as program directors that we have to face a lot of things. And we see our parents facing similar things, our children, our families. And then this past year has kind of just taken all of that, and it becomes one thing on top of the another on top of another. And that can be very traumatic for not only us as providers and taking that on, but also working with others. So what we need to realize is resilience is not something that just happens innately. It's not an automatic thing that people have this ability to bounce back when difficult things happen. And so we're also very sensitive to our environment around us. Sometimes parents are having trouble adapting to a new situation, as all of us did over the past year. That impacts our ability to bounce back, that resilience. And really, it's just simple but brain science when you think about it. When we're in a situation where we feel threatened or disrespected, it causes this like part of our brain to activate, that fear activates. And then it's really hard for us to process things. And sometimes we just choose to shut down. So I'm sure many of you all over the past year have had a time where you felt like you needed to retreat or shut down. Well, even before COVID, we have parents, families that we deal with, that they have a tendency when they don't know how to cope and they don't have that coping mechanism, or they're somehow afraid or feel like they're backed into a corner, that they shut down. We see that with our kiddos, right? Sometimes our kiddos back down. They kind of retreat. So it's really important that we identify that for what it is in parents. A lot of times we might think, oh, well, that parent just doesn't want to talk to us, when really that parent might be having some difficulties and that ability to kind of bounce back, whether it be in your setting or things that happen before they come in. So just being aware that not everyone may be as resilient as you are, and that resilience fluctuates for all of us, is really very key into tuning into children as well as tuning into the families who are serving those kiddos.
So as LaDonna goes through these protective factors, you're gonna probably find yourself relating to a lot of these. I know that we're really talking about parents, but you're probably in your mind gonna go, wow, what if I just took off person, the word parent, and changed it to say person resilience? How do my staff manage stress? How do my staff function well when faced with challenges? How do my staff and myself work with adversity and trauma? So keep that in mind too as we go, because it's not just parent-centered, it's parent, child, and people-centered. And you might have some things that jump out at you. Again, our focus is families and putting this in with your families, but know that this is very, very applicable to you and to your staff as well.
So I want to share with you just some ways that you can do in everyday actions to demonstrate that your parents are valued, because that's really at the root of it, right? When I feel valued as a person, I'm more likely to bounce back, right? Than when maybe I'm fearful or maybe feel like I'm in a situation that's new that I don't know how to navigate that. So the most important thing that you can do to help in everyday actions for parents is to demonstrate that your parents are valued in multiple ways. It's important to honor each family's race, language, culture, history, and their approach to parenting. It's really important to tune into their approach and how they're parenting. We want to encourage parents to manage their stress effectively. We want to support them as decision makers and help to build leadership skills even in our parents. And it's very hard sometimes to figure out, now, how is it that we can do that? But it does go beyond maybe having a parent on your board as to what decisions they're making for their child in their classroom, in your classroom. What's going on day to day that they can be involved in and making decisions and moving their child's life forward and propelling them forward. And then we want parents to very much tune in, key in to the fact that they are the person that needs to buffer their child during their child's stressful times. So it's important that they're able to buffer that stress in their lives, and they can teach their children how to do that as well.
Sorry, had to unmute. See, I was doing really good, and I got the unmute flow going. So what I'm going to talk to you about in between each one of these protective factors is how I use, here at iKids, how I use the protective factors to make sure that the family engagement opportunities that I'm planning for families are touching each one of the factors, each one of the six factors. Right now, we're talking about the first one, which is parent resilience. And so some of the ways that, and stay tuned, because in a minute, I'm going to ask you a prompt in the chat for you to put some of your ideas as well. Before I go further, if you have just entered into the training, we need you to put your name and your center in the same line, put them together. So name, then center, first and last name as it appears in ECE TRIS so that you can get credit. So we need to start there. Secondly, the PowerPoint will be available for you after, so don't worry about that. And in the PowerPoint are all the links that I'm going to share with you today. So I wanted to make sure that you had that little bit of housekeeping information. So I know we've had several people just flood into the meeting here. Please go ahead and put your full name and your center in the chat so that we, and it's okay, Connie Turner Trainer, whatever you need to do so that we can make sure that we have you accounted. So how do we here spotlight family resilience? You notice in the beginning when LaDonna started talking and she had the six protective factors shown, each of them had a colored star next to it. In order for me to make sure that I am meeting all protective factors throughout the variety of parent activities that we do, I've color-coded them. So you'll see on this corner of this page, I have a blue dot or a blue star. You'll understand that a little more later, but right now I'm going to tell you some of the things that we do for parent resilience. So using social media, we oftentimes do family spotlights. If we have each month, say an activity, you'll see one coming up that we did in January, and it was an activity that was family reading night. Now remember, the COVID rules mean that they can't come into our space to read, but they can read at home. And so if they would take a photo of their family reading, then we can spotlight that family on social media, showing essentially kudos to them, great job taking the time, we're proud of you, let's celebrate those families on our social media pages. We also have a parent advisory board. The parent advisory board meets quarterly, and they, especially during COVID, have had a lot of wonderful responsibilities. Things like when things were set to reopen, reading that health and safety protocol and procedure and giving their feedback on how they felt it would affect them. Remember, if you have lots of great parents on board, they can talk to each other and be great support to you. Every month, we have a Strengthening Families meeting. We still have those. Pre-pandemic, they were in person. Right now, they're all Zoom cafes. And if you want to find out a little more about hosting a parent cafe or using that model, it's a beautiful model. We have ways to connect you to that later. But that is one of the ways that we get our families together, whether it be in Zoom or in person, to talk about the needs that the parents have. Some of the conversations have been about bed sharing. Some have been about discipline. Some have been about preparing for kindergarten. All of the different Strengthening Families meetings will have different topics based on what the parents want to talk about. And then finally, especially during this time of COVID, it's been really important to give our parents access to internet supports. And I'm gonna click on this button so that you can see what this support looks like. And by the way, if you're just entering, be sure to hit mute. We love hearing your small friends and we love hearing your nap time music. But LaDonna's been driving for 15 hours and she might fall asleep. So Kids in the House is a fantastic website to share with your families. It's a wonderful resource. And if you notice on it, it has all kinds of different topics from baby to toddler to preschool to elementary to teen to special needs. It has different experts, different videos. You can search a topic. A great place for you to go to find supports to help support that parent resilience. You can find articles on here to share. These are great places to find some information to share on your social media. All of these fantastic things that you can do to share these things with your families. Now, I just shared a little bit of the things that we do that touch on parent resilience. I'd like for you to take a moment in the chat and think about the parent resilience component. Think about the parent activities and family engagement activities and family involvement activities that you do, and put the ones in the chat that you think support parent resilience. And I'm going to scroll back. You can see the actions for parent resilience. Looking at those actions, just take a minute to put in the chat what is maybe an activity idea, engagement activity, something that you do that helps with parent resilience. We've got 50 participants on here, so I know we've got some additional great ideas. LaDonna's going to sing while you're.
I was just thinking of, while you top it in, I was thinking of ways that you even value families. You know, the way that we maybe text families during the day to let them know that their child is doing well. Or maybe if you know that parent is having just a struggle that day, just keeping in daily communication with them with the app shows that you value them as a parent. You want to see them, you want them to see what's going on with their child, and you are honoring them as that child's family.
We've got some great things on here. We have science fairs at pickup in the chat. We have assistant directors communicating so they see and talk to somebody. Sending pictures of their kiddos during the day. Because I can guarantee, you know, parents so often just hear the bad, right? They want to know, how was their day? And they do it like this. They go, how was their day? With a scrunchy face. Because they're afraid to hear maybe that their kiddo needed some additional support. So all those beautiful pictures to say, look at your kiddo holding their pencil correctly, or look at them playing nicely with a friend, especially as we work on building that resilience for families to see their child being successful. How wonderful is that as a parent to receive that note of success so that they too as a parent in turn kind of feel a little bit successful. I think we've all had to become very much digital. And so using those digital apps to communicate with our parents has been a good thing. I know that I'll be happy when our parents can enter back into the building. There are some folks that are saying, no, I like this way. And each group will decide on their own. But I miss the comings and goings of the families myself. Guys, thanks for sharing these great ideas in the chat. These are so valuable. Keep them coming as we go. We are our best resources. Again, I'm just sharing a little sample, and we are here to support each other and to do some great sharing. So please fill up those chats with those ideas.
Big, right? To living in a bubble. There was even probably about 6 months that I didn't see my grandchildren inside at all. And then after a while, very limited capacity. It's just been in the past few weeks since I received my second COVID shot that my coming and goings with them does not include a mask. So social connections with my family, with those outside of my family, has certainly diminished over the past year. Usually I would see Jennifer maybe once a month and we would talk. She lives right down the road from me at her center. And I haven't got to see her in a really long time, except for we met up outside to talk about this training. So I know how important it is to have those social connections, especially when those were kind of just swiped away from some of us. But we have parents that we're dealing with, not all, but some parents who have really a lot of problems sometimes merging and meshing into that social fabric. They might retreat some. They might be those parents who you say, oh, they don't want to come to a parent engagement activity that we have, even if it's outside. They don't want to do those things. When actually they need a bridge. Some parents need a bridge to help them begin to have those social connections. We know how important that is for us as individuals to have social connections as people. Guess what? It's important for everyone to have a sense of community. Just some people need that extra support. They need positive relationships that provide emotional, informational, instrumental, and spiritual support in their lives. We know that we need that. All of our parents need that. And our children need to see our parents doing those things. So how can we do that? What are those everyday social connections, those everyday actions that we can make with families? Well, we can help them feel valued, as we've talked about before. We can help to build a relationship with our families, our relationship. We can also help them to sustain and use social connections. Jennifer mentioned some things, and we'll talk about some other things that help parents build social connections in her center. We have to take that extra step right now to be able to do that, because those things aren't happening naturally, right? We're having to facilitate, make plans for safety for ourselves when we're having social connections, and also for our families as well. It's so important that we create a very inclusive environment in our centers to help provide mutual support for the parents, to also promote engagement in the community and participation in engagement activities. So I know we're not fully opened up back up right now, but things like helping parents to establish even maybe new parents in our centers, brand new parents, to help build that bond with them, with other parents, with other families, to help them see, post something about the library is having an event. There's a community event. I know many of you have community resource bulletin boards that can support families, and you can tell them about activities that are going on as we open back up, and maybe even some safe social settings that we can participate in now.
So someone had a really good question. Connie Turner had a great question. It said, how do you feel about connecting on social media with parents? Connie, I would recommend that you have a page for your center and encourage parents to connect with you through that center page. That way that you can keep it professional. And I would use that as the page and share from that safely. It's going to be up to each individual person should they choose to connect with families on their personal level. But that brings with it its own level of eek, because then on your personal page, you know, it's your personal. So if you have staff and other people sharing personal things with families that may not be in that family's comfort zone, that's something you might need to look at in your staff and personnel policies. But as far as a page for your center, absolutely. We have one of those here. It's iKids Childhood Enrichment Center. You're welcome to join it and check it out and see the different types of things we share with families. It's been really hard for social connections in Zoom, right? Because we're all feeling alienated. We're all feeling less socially connected. And so how have I been able to maintain those social connections in Zoom? And so what we have are Zoom family sessions. I'm going to share one here with you. Hang on, let me share. I'm going to stop share. I'm going to reshare because I did not connect to one of my screens here real fast. So let me get all these put back in so you can see. So what I'm sharing with you is one of our Zoom family sessions that I have them quarterly. They are seasonally based. You can find them on our Facebook channel if you really have time to watch them. We typically have about 80 kiddos in little Zoom boxes. For that family activity, we will have the each kiddo, as they go home, they get a little kit for the night, and it has activity props in it that they're going to use. I'm going to show you just a brief smidget of what it looks like. I'll fast forward through some things on what a Zoom playroom looks like from my living room. And this is the fun part for everybody coming in.
Hi, everybody.
And then as the night goes on, there are different activities with the friends. My face is stuck. We read stories. All of those things are in here for them. We do some, it's almost like Blue's Clues on steroids. This was a gingerbread story that went with it, and I ate the cookie. It was really good. You can enjoy the whole thing. They last 20 minutes, but you are free to enjoy the whole thing at your leisure. If you click over to our Facebook page, they're there.
Cookies.
What?
Did you see the
five cookies in the oven?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
No way! So hang on just 1 minute. I'm missing one cookie. I wonder where it could be. See my special guest in the corner? So that is an example of a seasonal theme-based activity. And then another way that we share information to get that out to families is through our platform that we use, which is called KMU. And I'll show that to you here in just a minute as well, so that you have access to that too. So let me pull out of this. Again, you can see all of these fabulous things on our fun Facebook page. We have them for each season as well. And you can check that out on your leisure. But it is a lot of fun because it does build those connections for our families. The other thing that we do, and LaDonna spoke a little bit about that, but to build those social connections because families can't come into our space, is have in our posts to families, things going on in the community for the weekend. So back here in April, on April 11th, we let our families know that Land Between the Lakes was having a sheep meet and greet. And then they also sheared the sheep, and you can learn to use the spinning wheel, so which is pretty cool. So sharing that information with families where they can take advantage of the activities happening around your community is another way to build those social connections for them and get them to make those hookups. So if you can, in your Tina, you can get the Gingerbread Man on Amazon. And probably cheaper right now. So if you want to, please take a moment in the chat. How do you build social connections during a pandemic, right? We still have our e-regs, so we're still going to be limited in how we can build social connections. So how are you building social connections between families in your space? Start sharing those ideas with us in the chat. And LaDonna will sing again.
You don't want to hear me sing.
A lot of us are using Zoom parent meetings. Zoom is still, I believe, no cost for the first 40 minutes or so. So I encourage you to use that class-wide if you can. Classroom Facebook pages is another fantastic idea with your families as well to share that info so that they can see. I had something very interesting happen just earlier this week. We're doing family parent-teacher conferences. And they're after hours. And so the family can come after hours for their parent-teacher conference, similar to a tour, if you will. They're very limited and small.
It's recorded. And
the family came in and, oh, someone will have to mute. There you go. The family came in and it realized, dawned on me and them, they've not been in our space for a year. We still have drop-offs and pickups outside. And so this family had not seen this child's new classroom. And the child had been with us since one. The child is now preparing for kindergarten. And so they haven't been in for the past year and a half. And so we spent part of that parent-teacher conference giving a tour so that they were able to come in and see that classroom space. And so it was not only making connections, social connections with each other, but it was making that social connection back with the teacher and back with that lead staff. So keeping that in mind too, individually scheduled open houses, retours for current families might be something that is important as well. Lots of folks are using Facebook pages. Lots of people are using their social media. Want to also remind you, as you use Facebook and social media, make sure that your staff handbook and your parent handbook are back up to date so that they cover that social media and cover your policies as we use more digital media to communicate, making sure that we are responsible for those protections with privacy and making sure that we honor and respect parents that don't want to be featured on those pages.
Okay, this next protective factor I think is very, very important. Knowledge, they're all important, but this one especially, knowledge of parenting and child development. A lot of parents are looking at you as their expert, right? And we look at parents as experts on their children. So understanding child development and parenting strategies that support physical, cognitive, language, social, and emotional development. So I want you all just to think about not only maybe a struggle that you've had as a parent, but think about those kiddos that you serve in your childcare center and those parents. What are some things that we have struggled with or that parents have struggled with in our centers now? With having all of the things they need to know centered around social, emotional, physical, and cognitive development. Just take a few moments to tap in the chat box. I'll give you an example. What about biting? Don't we have a lot of parents that ask questions about biting, right? And some need to know that it might just be just a developmental that some children are biting, they're exploring. They might have trouble using their words. Somebody typed potty training. As you all type that in, I'm just going to throw some things out, but please continue. What are some things that parents turn to you about or that you believe parents need to know? Sometimes it's, oh, my baby won't stop crying. Those are very, very important things that we address. People are typing in things like challenging behaviors. What about understanding what's developmentally appropriate or what their child should be able to do at a certain point? That is so key. Someone typed getting along with classmates. Milestones. Yes, Stephanie, those developmental milestones that children are reaching. We have so many resources available to us on the internet, like the CDC Milestone app that Jennifer is going to showcase in just a little bit. Understanding what their child should be able to do, not only so they can recognize delays, as like Destiny typed in, but also so they can help that child reach that next milestone. It's just so very, very important during this time of COVID that we really take into account the fact that the parents are not coming into their centers, they're not seeing what their children are doing. So how can you help them know what their child is doing and what they will be able to do? So these are things that you can do. Everyday interactions to help build knowledge. We can model developmentally appropriate interactions with the children that we're serving, right? We can do that. We shouldn't, as childcare teachers or childcare providers, have expectations for children that are not realistic for their age. Children, when they are young, have challenging behaviors. Some children bite. A lot of these things are just normal stages that children are going through. So it's important that we not only communicate with parents about resources, about development, but we're also modeling those in the classroom. We want to encourage parents to observe when they can, when that's safe in the classroom, but we do want to encourage them to ask questions, explore parenting strategies with them, and parenting issues. And sometimes we might have something that works for one day that doesn't work the next day, right? This parenting strategy worked. Now I'm getting a different signal from my child, a different behavior, or maybe even that same behavior is showing up again. It might be for a different reason. Sometimes we have to recalculate, as our GPS map tells us when we're driving, because children don't come with a book. This is what you can expect from a child on this day, right? We're always trying to figure out new strategies, new things that will work. And then this is very key. And I know, because I was a childcare provider for 12 years, it is important to address parenting issues from a strength-based perspective. So when we're talking about that knowledge being a very important factor that still feeds back into social connections. If I don't have a relationship with that parent, if I don't have a positive social connection with that parent, they might not take the knowledge that I need to share with them in the very same way, right? If I'm not valuing them, if I'm not valuing and looking at that resilience factor, they might not take the knowledge that I'm wanting to share with them to help their family in the same way. So we have to approach parents from a strength-based perspective in order for them to hear what we're saying. When I think about someone imparting knowledge to me, and if they're doing that in a way that I don't feel valued, even if they're not intentionally trying to do that, if I don't feel valued, I can't hear them. So that's really important that we do everything when we talk to parents about parenting concerns, parenting strategies, that we talk to them from a strength-based perspective.
So some of the things that we do to address knowledge of parenting and child development, we do something that are called daily and weekly conversation starters. Again, I'm going to click out of this. We use KAYMBU, K-A-Y-M-B-U. Some of you guys use something called Hi Mama. I mean, there are so many types of things that you can use to communicate with your parents daily, in addition to our everyday daily sheet, which is what they ate, did they potty, basic things that they played. We're also going to give them something called a conversation starter. And that conversation starter is going to take an activity that we did. It may be a video. It may be photos. But it's going to show them a snapshot of what was captured during the day. The other thing we're going to put in there is a teeny tiny paragraph that talks about what we did, what we worked on while they were with us, pedaling a bicycle. The skill needed for pushing and pulling the legs is a skill that really develops between 4 and 5 years of age. Look, there was a developmental thing that we talked about right there within describing or showing the activities that the friends did in that space. We also talked to give them stuff to talk about. And we give them prompts, right? You're very good at prompting your children and asking your children questions. Well, sometimes when parents get in the car, the thing they like to say is, how was your day? And, or what did you do today? And their answer is, I don't know, or good. So a lot of times the great thing is, can you balance eggs with Play-Doh? Does it take some skill and slow hands? And then asking the question, which stack is taller? So now the parents can look with their child at the end of the day and check that right there with them. Jessica's asking, how in the world do you get this done? Actually, it's quite fast within this, and it happens during nap time, during documentation. So it's not a tough thing to do because we're used to doing it constantly. Also, with us, with Kambu, we tag these into different developmental domains. So it's actually our ongoing documentation that we're using. So we are able to put together a lot of assessments and all those things using the things that we have in this. But that would be one of the things that we do, an ongoing conversation starter with our parents. Another thing that you can do where you give parents information so that they can track milestones, not just you tracking them, but the parent tracking them, is the CDC milestone tracker. In the chat, would you please tell me, have you heard, yes, I've heard of the milestone tracker app, or no, I have not heard of the milestone tracker app? You should just reply yes or no. So I see lots of no's, which is sad, but exciting, right? So the CDC Milestone Tracker app is something that you can push out to parents. I have the link. It'll be in your PowerPoint, but you can Google CDC Milestone Tracker app. Each parent, and you can download it for free. It is free. It's an iOS and an Android. Even has it in Spanish. You go in, you put your child's name, you put their birthday, and then, thank you, Christine. And the app starts to send you, can your child do this? Your child should be doing this. Here's some great videos. Here's some ideas. Here's some things you can do. And you're tracking your child's milestones. The very interesting thing is if there are any hiccups, if the parent is answering no, they're not doing certain things, it helps prompt the parent to what the next step should be. I a couple years ago, made some pretend children. And I still get prompts from my pretend children from the app asking me if they're doing X and Y, and they're pretend children. So no, they're not. But I encourage you, get all of your families to use this milestone tracker. It is fantastic. There's more though, and I could sell this program to you. It's free, but there's more. Early childhood educators have access within the CDC milestone tracker and the CDC page here to click. If you notice here, it says early childhood educators. You actually have access to free materials. You have access to books. You have access to things that you can share on your social media page about child development. And Christine, reach out to her. She's your milestone tracker person. Please reach out to her, because we really want all of our families to make this something that they have and that they use every day. Why is it great? Why do we use it with our families? So when our families on day one enter our program, we give them the ability to sign in to be able to view our cameras, the paperwork to be able to pay their bills, and we give them this milestone tracker app, and we ask them to put that on there. Because it helps us when we're having conversations back and forth with how's your child's development doing. It helps us to have the same language when we're talking about, in this example, it's Jaden, he's 10 months old. When we're talking and sharing that language with families on where their child is and where they're going, using the app as shared language. So I encourage you, this is a fantastic thing. And I encourage you to take advantage of that free opportunity. And again, if you have questions, Ms. Christine has all kinds of information for you, but I would love after today, if nothing else, everybody get your families using this amazing milestone tracker app. The other thing that you have access to and that we want you to bring into your program, and we want you to, because we do, hook up with your community early childhood mental health specialist. You can invite them to contribute to your monthly newsletter. And yes or no, do you know who your community early childhood mental health specialist is? Yes or no in the chat. And should you not, I have a solution for you. You just simply go to this fabulous page and you can see this is about what the early childhood mental health program is. So I didn't want to just give you access to find this person without some understanding on what the early child mental health person is for community. So we have access to these fabulous people and they can come into your space and you can find out who your person is on this corner here. You can see the contact list. You can also see the regions map. So they do, here are some of the things that they do. They help do consultations in your centers. They can help do training for your staff on social, emotional, and behavioral needs. They can also do trainings with your families. And then they can do evaluations, assessments, and therapeutic services for children birth through five and their families. Guys, we have access to this. There is great funding for these people. They're in our communities. We need to invite them into our space and we need to use them. They are a resource. How many times have you thought to yourself, gosh, if I could only have someone to come in here and observe this friend? And not only can they observe one friend, they can observe your entire classroom and they can talk about some strategies to help your staff on how they can work better with some classroom management. There's so many great things that you can do. Again, there's links to this in your PowerPoint, but I encourage you reach out, hook up, hook in, because it's going to help you to get your parents with that knowledge of parenting and child development that we're talking about.
As a previous childcare provider, I use the early childhood mental health specialist. They've been around for a really long time. That person might have switched. You might have been in contact with someone at one time. Then someone else got the position and you didn't know. Sometimes those things happen and we lose contact. So please take an opportunity to reconnect with them. And that is a concrete support for you to have that early childhood mental health specialist as we move into this one. So the next protective factor is concrete support in times of need. For the sake of time, I think we all know what that means. I'm not going to go through everything, but it's access to that support. We need to respond in our everyday actions when families have a crisis, when they have a need. If you know a family is hungry, you can share a resource with them, a food bank maybe in your area. You have community resource bulletin boards in many of your centers where you have those. And there have been some centers who have shared COVID resources with families. Those are very, very important during this time. So we want to provide information and connection to the community for our parents, for our families. And we also want them to help develop those skills that they need to sometimes identify, oh, I have a need here. And there's someone out there to help me. A lot of times it's difficult for people to ask for help. And so we need to encourage them to do so.
So again, for the sake of time, how do we find those things? If you have any persons in your center that have recently or at any point completed their Child Development Associate credential, one of the things they actually had to do was create a family resource guide. So have them share that with you and you can use that. Make sure you update it, especially update it each year. Your local preschool Head Start, reach out to them and see if they will share that resource with you. Your local churches often have community resource guides that they use. And most especially, your Chamber of Commerce actually has community resource guides that they put together. And so you can reach out to them to get those tangible pamphlets. That way, if you know that a family is having trouble, maybe with meeting their heating needs, paying for utilities, all of those different things, it can cover the gamut when it comes to that. And then don't forget in your newsletter that you send out to families, put a little corner in there that talks about resources for families. One of the most basic is, how do I sign up for the Child Care Assistance Program? Who now qualifies? What are some of the benefits of that? As hopefully that continues to expand and we can have more families that can qualify, we want to make sure that we point that out to them. Those are resources for those families. A less threatening place to put that is in your newsletter so that the family can look at that, have that contact information, and reach out to that on their own.
The next protective factor that we want to introduce is social emotional competence of children. Family and child interactions help children develop the ability to communicate clearly, to recognize and regulate their emotions, and establish and maintain relationships. This is huge, right? We talk about this being foundational to school success. Children being ready to enter kindergarten or preschool or Head Start, we want to make sure that the families are able to have the skills to help them regulate their child's emotions and establish and maintain these relationships, because all of those things are indicators of good child outcomes. So the ways we can do that is help parents foster their child's social emotional development. We can include those kind of activities in our programming that we do with children. We can help children develop a positive cultural identity so they can interact with a diverse society. And we also want to respond proactively when social emotional development needs that extra support. That happens sometimes, right, with our kiddos. And we want to make sure that we're modeling positive social emotional development for our parents and for our children, and that we can help them take that on with them when they enter school.
So the way that we do that, to put that in practice, I showed you how we use class photos for support and prompts for our families. But I also have a section in my feed for my families that talks about hot topics. And so, again, a newsletter that talks about some of those hot topics with families. This one specifically was about guns, zombies, and superhero play. Talking to our families about how we do that and what that looks like in our space. The art of pretend play in preschool. And if you say to yourself, but I don't know how to write or what to put that in there, that kids in the house site that I shared with you has all kinds of supports that you can embed into your family newsletters, into your Facebook pages, to get those parents to read and see so that they understand what you're talking about. Again, it's really important for me when I see a hot topic flaring up to give information first so that families can see that and be on that same page with me. Again, what is playing rough? What does it talk about fighting for truth and justice? A hot topic could be biting. A hot topic could be potty training. I know for us, this putting a positive spin on play and role-playing difficult situations. Again, we're in this digital media area where this is the fastest way to contact with parents. Once this has gone out and we have parents that have read it and they've looked at it, we've talked about our ongoing aggression, then we might have to take some time to get back with that parent to connect with them with that professional support. And so I like to call that a parent sandwich. I do a whole training on the parent sandwich, but briefly, whenever I do have to talk to a parent about that hot topic on that social emotional competence, I'm going to start out with the positive from the kiddo, the meat of what the challenge is, some lettuce and tomato on how to support that, and then end it with a positive on the kiddo again. So the sandwiches, we're really talking about the kiddo and the good things that they have and their strengths. It's that strengths-based approach. But I'm also going to talk about the meat too. But before I even got to that, I was giving them information to get them ready so that they could know kind of what the hot topic was in this space. Again, this one was on guns, swords, and superhero play. Again, don't forget, you also have access to Kids in the House. That's that website I shared at the very, very beginning. And I encourage you to check that out and see that too. How do you, and again, for the sake of time, because we'll run out of time here soon, but just take very quickly and fill in the chat, how do you support, especially during COVID? Again, we're still gonna have these COVID restrictions for a little while. So how are you doing parent engagement to support social emotional competence in light of COVID going on? Pre-COVID, how we did, one of the ways we did is inviting parents in, obviously, but one of the best family activities that we had pre-COVID, and I'll share this while you're typing in the chat, was grandparents lunch. And we would have over 100 grandparents. Again, thanks to COVID, we haven't had it, but over 100 grandparents come in for grandparents lunch. And that was a great way for social emotional competence because grandparents would come in and see the great things their kiddos were doing, see them being able to open their milk, seeing them be able to sit as a group, and they would visually see how competent their children were, and then they could go and continue to encourage that as well. Again, go ahead, don't forget in your chat to put in how you are supporting social and emotional competence with your families, parent team meetings, conferences, parent trainings. Thank you, Christina, I appreciate that. How many of you, and just you can self-reflect, you don't have to answer. A lot of times this is the most touchiest subject. Parent conferences can be touchy because we don't want to discuss the hard things. So this one can be tough, and that's why I encourage you, conscious discipline mini sessions are fantastic, but I encourage you to get yourself lots of resources, and the Kids in the House is fantastic space to do that. Yes, Destiny, celebrating those milestones at every pickup is great. LaDonna talked before about those social connections. Celebrating those milestones at pickup are going to build those connections. So when you really have to get into that social emotional competence, it's not as hard a conversation. It's still a hard conversation. Parent roundtables are great. Those are fantastic. And yes, Cynthia, showing those great things that they're doing and showing the improvement of all the skills is wonderful.
So the last protective factor that we want to talk about is nurturing and attachment. This is really key. It's really important that parents build strong connections with their children. It's a child's relationship with a consistent, caring adult and how that impacts a child's ability to form and maintain relationships with others. Now that caring adult can be you at the child care center, right? It can be a teacher. But also when we have parents who are bringing in their children or dropping them off the door at the door during COVID, we might have noticed that we saw some kiddos for the very first time, right? And they're clinging on to their parents and they don't want to leave, especially if they're going into a new space that they're not familiar with. And some people might say, oh, they just need to let go and go on with the teacher and they'll be okay. And they will be okay if we encourage them that their parent is going to be back. And we can put prompts in the classroom, maybe a picture of their mom or dad. But those are things that I want to see happening because that means they have that attachment, that secure attachment to their parent. This is so important to their development. So one way we can do that is modeling nurturing care to children. When that parent is having to rip their child off their arm and they're coming on to us, they're coming with us, right? They're holding our hand. They're with us. We're helping them to feel that closeness. We're letting them that it's going to be okay to provide those warm and consistent responses to foster a secure and strong attachment with the children.
You've all talked about your morning welcome, your drop-off routine. A lot of times, many of you have said it's your director or assistant director who's out front or bringing them in right now because of COVID. We all have different practices in place to kind of mitigate that spread and to follow those regulations of not people into our space. And that morning welcome is key. You want to make sure whoever that morning welcome person is, either they've had lots of caffeine or lots of coffee so they can be the greatest cheerleader in the world in the morning, and then give them donuts so that they can carry it out throughout the rest of the day. Other things that we do, and we are going to give you a tool for this. So we're actually going to give you the ability to do a nurturing and attachment thing with your families as well as we go forward. So the idea is that you would, after today, able to do your very own family reading or family movie night. And the one that we are using for this is, and I've used this before, I've done this. I'm really excited that there's now a Netflix movie, so I can add that to it. But it's based on a book called Yes Day. Now, a little bit of history about Yes Day. When my kiddos were in, I have a kiddo in college now and a kiddo in high school. When my child was in elementary school, my Izzy, she found this book. It was a Scholastic book, and it came and it was called Yes Day. And so obviously she got it, she read it, and she said, I want a Yes Day. Well, I'm like, what's a Yes Day? I tell you yes all the time. Well, actually, I probably didn't tell her yes all the time. I was really good at saying no a lot. And so I told her, I said, at the very end of school, the very last day of school, we will have our own Yes Day. And it will be that Saturday after school is over. And you get to pick and choose and do everything you want. And I will have to tell you yes. Now, there's a monetary limit on there, right? And so she was so excited. And this fabulous book called Yes Day is all about a day this friend, it's one day a year. Yeah, so we don't do it all the time, is able to ask his mom and dad something and they say yes. The cool thing about YouTube, the cool thing about the internet is that whenever you share something with a parent and they have access to this, there are read alouds out there for you. Now we're gonna be sending you this book for your participation today as long as you do all the fabulous things we're gonna ask at the end. But so that you can implement this Yes Day with your families. How are we going to do it? Well, the teacher's gonna read the Yes Day book in the classroom. You saw already how we communicate with families using our Kambu. We're gonna send home with them the links to the read aloud, which I will show you in a moment. And then we're also gonna send them home with a little package of popcorn, and we're going to decorate it with string. We do it every year. We have family movie night every year, sending home popcorn for the family. And then we send them home on the attached to the popcorn is a little pretend movie ticket. In the past, we've encouraged them to choose whatever movie they wanted, as long as they sent us a picture that they were in the movie while they watched the movie. It's usually parents eating their popcorn. We ask them to share it to our social media page, which was great because it got more people involved in your social media. That's great marketing, by the way. And they could watch whatever the movie they wanted. Well, this gives a great idea for them to see the movie Yes Day if you haven't already seen it. It's a Netflix movie, but if not everybody has Netflix, choose whatever movie you want. So what I will do is I'll read Yes Day in my classroom. I'll talk to parents about what a Yes Day looks like. We're gonna encourage them to say yes to a family movie night. We're gonna give them and send them home with popcorn to pop in their microwave. We're gonna give them the prompt of the movie ticket. And then we're also going to encourage them. What are we doing? We are building, nurturing, and attachment. Here's the read aloud for you to see.
Yes.
This is an example of the book. Again,
today
you can send
is
this,
my favorite day of the year.
If they don't have the book,
yes,
they can see it
day.
This way. We won't read the whole thing.
Just watch. You'll see what I mean. Can I please have pizza for breakfast? Can I use your hair gel?
See the next page? She's taking a family photo with spiky hair.
Say cheese. Can I clean my room tomorrow? Later mess. Can I?
So again, all those fun things for Yes Day with them. You send them the read aloud so that if they don't have the book, they can see the book. And then you also give them access, you know, a link to the Netflix movies, movie trailer.
If there's one thing I've learned from being a mom, it's that parents and kids always disagree on one thing.
No.
Rules.
But saying no 50 times an hour?
No, absolutely not.
Nope on a rope.
It's part of the job.
All of that is about to change.
You heard about Yes Day? It's this new thing where parents say yes to everything their kids ask for 24 hours.
Radical!
How am I just hearing about this?
Well, Yes Days are like fun in mom.
All right, so that is, again, a fun little thing with the movie. Some of you have seen the movie, but we are encourage you to have and put in practice a family activity that we got it all spelled out for you here that will support the nurturing and attachment of your families. Now, if you noticed along the way, each little slide I'll back up has had a color-coded star at the bottom. It's been important for me as I use the protective factors to be very intentional when I am doing my family activities. And so when I get to the end of a month, and you can do it however you want. You can highlight your family activities via color. You could use a star stickers, you know, Walmart sells star stickers. I can do the foil stickers on there if I want to. But I need to self-assess to see how many, number one, parent activities am I doing a month? And I also need to self-assess, am I covering all the protective factors? Because to me, it is so important that I do provide opportunities through each quarter that has addressed and supported each and every one of the six protective factors. So you see an example on here of one of my, this is January 2021. I chose January because it was a COVID time, still is a COVID time, so that you can see how we used protective factors and still were able to have three family involvement, family engagement activities in the month of January that actually touched on three different protective factors. Strengthening families parent meeting via Zoom, family reading day was the Zoom playroom read aloud that we had. And then you see, please share a photo of your child reading with you on our social media page. Again, a prompt for them to do that. It's important for me to make sure that I assess and see within my space what types of things I'm doing that intentionally support the protective factors through family engagement. And I encourage you, as you look back, and you're going to do that here in a bit, as you look back at all the family engagement activities that you do, which ones are you maybe not using? And hopefully you can come up with some ideas after what we have shared today to be able to do all of those protective factors. So I'm going to put a link to this Google form in the chat so that you can have access to it. It's an accountability thing for you so that we can make sure too that you are able, let me go back here, hit the right button, so that you can, it's going crazy on me. I'm hitting too many buttons. And I'll send this to all of you, just a second. So that you can check on that Google form, click on that, open that up, and be able to answer some of those questions. If you have been involved currently in answering throughout today, you've actually answered a lot of the questions that are provided to you within this Google chat, within this Google form. We don't have a whole lot of time. LaDonna, do we still want to do a quick breakout for everybody?
Yeah, I think we can do a quick breakout, maybe 7 or 8 minutes.
Okay. So you have a Google form. I sent that to you. I've also sent the link to you in the chat. You can copy and paste that. You can click on that to open that Google form. What we do need you to fill that out, that's accountability for you too. And that way also we can come back to you and say, hey, how can we continue to support you in this, in your quest to do all things great with putting and combining those protective factors intentionally in your parent engagement program. So we're gonna have some breakouts. We're gonna put you into some breakout rooms. And while you're in that breakout, we're just gonna ask you, somebody take the lead, whoever, take it fast, because there's not gonna be a lot of time. Take the lead and you're gonna have the opportunity to share very briefly and very quickly your most favorite family involvement activity, maybe your most unique family engagement activity. Remember, there's a difference between involvement and engagement. So try to share that with your team that's listening. And then we'll come back together and do a quick blowout and share some of those great ideas.
So right. 8 minutes. We're going to give you 8 minutes. It's 1:14 now. So Brandon.
Right. I'm going to see if I can get these all broken out. How many
people?
Jennifer, I think Brandon might be working on it for you.
They're doing it for us. So whenever you all go to the breakout rooms, make sure you're connect and share. It could be something you're already doing. It could be something that you heard today that you want to share. But we are so much more likely to take something that we've learned in a training when we make plans to be intentional to transfer that into our workplace. So it could very well just be something that you're planning on doing. You can build on one another, but we're just going to take about 8 minutes to do that as soon as Brandon sends you off. So connect even maybe just about something you liked about this training that you would like to make part of your program with your families. It could be to do the Milestone Tracker app, which we would love, and to find out more information from that by emailing Christine.
Thanks for the plug. Hello, everybody.
Hi.
I will real fast. Let me go back to share the screen for those housekeeping thingies.
I don't know that we have time to share out if we're going to maintain and stay on here with Christine, if we had anybody who did not get to type their name in the chat. That's what I was concerned about.
So some quick housekeeping things we want you to do as everybody flies back into our bigger meeting. If you did not do so, you need to please put your name and your center together in the same line in the chat so that we know you are present. The second thing we need you to do is to complete that Google form. I sent it in the chat. You can click it there. You'll also receive via email this PowerPoint, but we do want you to complete that Google form so that we can reach out to you later and see if there's any support you need. Also within that Google form is the opportunity for you to tell us what we did well and what we did weller, because that's a word, So we do want you to share that with us because hopefully we've given you some great ideas. Do all of these things because it is through doing these things that you get the fabulous Yes Day book. And without doing these things, the Yes Day book will not come your way. So we want to make sure so that you can get the Yes Day book and you can get your 1.5 training hours. That's important too. So because your year is almost up, June is coming quickly. That's your friendly PSA.
I'm going to turn it over to Christine for just a minute. But again, as I mentioned at the beginning, my name is LaDonna Butler. I'm a TA specialist in the western far west part of the state in the Lakes and Two Rivers. But we couldn't have done any of this today with Child Care Aware if Christine and her many helpers had not helped us get on. So Christine, thank you so much. And did you want to say anything in closing?
Yes, I certainly do. Well, thank you. Huge, huge, huge thanks to LaDonna and Jennifer. If you don't mind, if you could just put your emails in the chat, just in case anybody in our audience does want to reach out to you directly, I think that would be handy. I know in my breakout group, there was somebody that was really interested in parent cafes. I'm like, you got to call LaDonna. So that's something that she's looking forward to doing. But thank you very much. The embedding of the protective factors into this presentation just warms my heart. I hope that has really encouraged and lots of the providers here. Such a wealth of ideas, both in the chat and through the presentation. I wish I was in the classroom again because there's so many things that I wish I could do, but I'm not working directly with families, so I'm counting on you for implementing as many of these ideas as possible. If you are one of the people that has a phone number listed rather than your name, if you could just stay on and make sure that we get like the name that's coordinating with the phone number, we just want to make sure everyone is getting the right credit. We will send out tomorrow the PowerPoint as well as I'll probably include that Google form link because it's a real gift that these presenters will really read through that feedback and then follow up with you directly. So that's a really, really nice perk. So like this is not a one and done training. They really want to be there to support you in the long run. For those of you that may have logged on a little bit late or got bumped off due to connectivity, we are recording this session. And so you can go back, or if you have friends that like, oh my gosh, there were so many ideas. You're going to have to check this out. Like we'll send that link to you so that you will have that available to you. We will do some closed captioning on that. So it won't be posted for just a little bit, but I will send that link out once it becomes available. I'm trying to think here. If there were anything else that I wanted to, oh, the books. So we will be mailing those books out directly to each of you. And so that will probably be, you know, within the next couple of weeks. I'm not exactly sure how quickly we can get those orders placed and how long it will take for them to ship, but we will certainly move on that by this week. There are openings for some of our future events in this series. And so please, if you have not registered for those, you are more than welcome to join us. And I will leave these last couple of minutes for any questions or closing comments. And again, stay on the line just an extra couple minutes if you are one of those people with phone numbers. So thank you again, everybody, for your participation, and particularly to our presenters and our staff behind the scenes. This was a lot to put together, but it was well worth it and really, really appreciate it. Any questions? See some props in the chat there. Fantastic presentation. All righty. Well, you are welcome to head on out and finish your day strong. And if you were formally registered for this session, your addresses were captured in the registration. And so we double checked that those were the best mailing addresses for you. If you have any questions, Arsene, if you can put your email in the chat box, that would be really helpful. That way people can reach out directly to you with any questions. And I guess we'll take our phone number people. Arsene, are there certain phone numbers that you're looking for? Thanks, everyone.
Bye.
We only had four.